Hello, this is Mitzi Goose, and I'm here to tell you about how my Toika Eeva arrived and got assembled all by myself. As you can see here in the crate, this is how the Eeva arrived. It actually arrived by freight truck, and you see there that there's a built-in pallet. So he was able to get the pallet jack under there and roll it right up to the garage. I had considered putting it in the garage, particularly in case I got tired and wanted just to close the garage door and not unpack it all in one day, but finally decided that it might be easier to disassemble the crate while it's on the driveway instead of in the garage. And it started raining later, so I don't know if it was better to put it in the garage or on the driveway, but I had him put it on the driveway. Once I took the crowbar and took the top off, you can then see in this picture down here where it was well sealed in plastic in case of rain or anything else happening in shipping. So what was inside the crate, once I got the plastic off and kind of the top layers down, you can kind of see that Toika used a lot of different boxes from all sorts of different materials and stuff to pack up the loom and also as spacers so that the contents wouldn't shift during the shipping. And when I was unpacking it, it did feel like an archaeological dig, and you can kind of see as I took each layer of stuff off, finally at the bottom, you find the side pieces of the loom. And I was a little surprised that they were fully assembled. I had expected them to actually be in pieces that you need to fasten together, but nope, it was all assembled. And I think in retrospect that them gluing it up at the factory, etc., will make the loom stronger than using knockdown bolts. The other thing that people might wonder about is the actual size of the crate, and you'll see that the crate size is actually dictated by the size of the side. So if you kind of measure the side pieces, you'll know the rough measurement of the crate. Breaking down the crate in the rain. So actually it only took about half hour to 45 minutes to haul all the pieces into the house, but breaking down the crate so that it would be, you know, in flat pieces was a huge pain in the butt. And in the middle of that, it started raining. Now, one thing you want to understand is that this crate is actually very valuable. It's got a lot of very quality wood in it. Finished birch is considered a premium woodworker wood, so you really want to try to save it. And if you are not a woodworker and you have no interest in the crate, trust me, if you call your neighbors and say free crate, they will take it within probably 2 or 3 hours. You'll find somebody who wants it and will haul it away. It took longer to break down the crate than it took to haul all the pieces of the loom into the house and assemble it. So it took quite a while. I spent a lot of time with the reciprocating saw, track saw, and everything trying to get it out. The nails they used were very long, and you don't want to be cutting through some of the big nails with a saw blade because that'll just wreck your saw blade. But like I said, it was worth it because it was roughly $100 to $150 worth of high quality lumber there. Okay, so how did I assemble this alone? And I had studied a lot of videos and such to try to figure this out, since most instructions will tell you to use two people. They don't really explain how to do it with one person. First step is you want to grab every woodworking clamp you own. Okay, and I really like these Irwin clamps that you see in the photos. I also have some Wen clamps, but the Irwin ones have really big, thick rubber padding so that Eeva will not get damaged. The first thing I did was I leaned the large side with the worm gear on it against the wall and then I put the two cross beams here in there. Once you put the cross beams in there, that side will stand up by itself. You can then put the clamps on. And when I say put it on loosely, what I mean is don't put the clamp all the way up next to the side piece. You want to put the clamp onto this square tenon part, but put it like at the edge. Don't put it all the way up close. You're going to need to be able to move the side piece a little bit along this tenon in order to get the warp beam and the cloth beam in. Once you've got the clamps on the other side that you can't see, put the other side on and then put the clamps on. And at this point, she'll stand up. Now, she's going to be loose, so don't put any weight on her, but she will stand up on her own. Then what you want to do is you want to put this top crossbar in. Put a clamp, and you can kind of see the clamp over here on this side. Put a clamp on that side, and I learned the hard way. I thought, oh, this is all going to hang together and everything's going to be fine. No, put the clamp on there, because when you push the warp beam and the cloth beam in, the sides need to push out a little bit, but if you don't put that clamp on, this side will fall off, and then you've run out of hands to try to manage that problem as well as the beam. Once you put your clamp on here, insert this geared part in first. Stand right here on this outside piece. Put the gear side in. Lift this area up so that it will go into the little hole that's on the other side of this beam that you can't see. And then you can kind of, while holding this beam, you can kind of push your body and get the side piece pushed in so that the beam won't fall out. And you're going to want to do the same thing on this side over here. So if you put the geared end in first, then try to hold the beam so that it will fit into the hole that's on the other side of this piece of wood here. And then you can try to push this side with your body or with your knee or whatever. At this point, you want to take one clamp off and put the wedge in, and walk around the loom and put the wedges in. So at this point, it's time to assemble the shaft. And everybody, you know, complains about their nails and their fingers and the O-rings. So that's when I tried several different tools to figure out how to do this, and I may do another video on that. I actually shot the video. I'm not sure if I'm going to publish it or not. But the ultimate winning tool was this one, which is a retaining ring plier. I had actually bought it for, of course, one use and have never used it since. That was at least 15 years ago. So I whipped it out. What I do is I put the ring over here on top of the two pins. You squeeze it and it will open the pins, which will make the ring bigger. You can then slide it onto the rod and then push the ring all the way up to the top. So what I would do is first, on these rods, there are two indentations on each side. Okay, put the inner ones first. Once you've got all the inner ones on, now you can come over here and put the outer one on so that it will hold the rod to the piece of wood. And what I found was that it was easier to do this with all of the pieces of wood all tied up. Now, the risk you run when you do it with the wood all tied up is that you can't see if any of these pieces of wood are cracked or anything. My loom actually came with a few extra pieces, and one of them had kind of a growth ring that had split off, and it really made the piece unusable because it would have caught the heddles. Since I had extras, I decided just not to use that piece. I did do some light sanding. I don't think that the shaft bars are anywhere near as bad as people make it out to be, but I will admit I did some light sanding with 400 grit. There were a few that may have needed a little bit more, but like I said, they gave you extras. Choose the best ones of the bunch and set aside the other ones. Now, the other thing I'll tell you is that you do get extra rings, and I will say that some of my rings ended up on the floor, never to be found again. Don't worry about that. You've got extra rings. But if you're worried like I am, just go ahead and buy some more rings just in case. And I provided the specification for you for the rings that I thought worked best.
So now don't forget, when you're assembling the shafts, put some TechSolve's heddles on the shaft bar before you put the other piece of wood on. If you don't do this, you will have to take off the other piece of wood to put your heddles on. And if you forget and don't do this until after your shafts are hung, then you're going to have to deal with the hung shaft as well as removing the piece of wood. So do it now. If you put the heddles on the way that I've illustrated here, then once the second piece of wood is on there, you can move the heddles so that you've got the heddles hanging from the top and the bottom bar as they should be. Now, while we're talking about heddles, let's talk about a heddle plan. In other words, how many heddles will go onto each shaft? Now, some things to consider are, one, it's a pain in the butt to add heddles after the fact, and it's particularly a pain in the butt to add them while you've got a warp that is partially threaded and you realize that you need more heddles. If you put different numbers of heddles on each shaft, you will want to have notes on how many heddles are on each shaft, or you will have to count the heddles or use hope to determine whether you're going to have enough or whether you're going to have to add more while you're threading the warp. If you have too many heddles and you weave the maximum width of the loom, then the extra heddles can actually rub up against the warp and cause pattern errors or shed issues. So too many is not a good thing either. Also, most people assume that if you have 32 shafts, that the shafts that are furthest in the back will have very few ends on them, and therefore you don't need that many heddles. While that is generally true for a 32 shaft draft, I think it's more often that you may have other situations requiring 32 shafts, such as a 16 shaft double weave or a situation where you want to split the heddles among multiple shafts. So with 32 shafts, I'm not really sure how many 32 shaft patterns I'm actually going to weave. However, I can imagine myself using 16 shafts when I have an 8 shaft draft, which requires 125 heddles on each shaft, but I only have 100. So in that case, instead of moving heddles to shafts 1 through 8, what I will do is use 16 shafts, and then shafts 1 and 9 represent shaft 1, shafts 2 and 10 represent shaft 2, and so on and so forth. Okay, and if you do that, then each shaft only requires 62 or 63 heddles because you will have twice as many shafts each with half of the number of heddles. So I think that I'm probably going to end up doing that a lot. I finally just decided to put 100 heddles per shaft, which is conveniently one bundle of TechSolve. Now, if I realize later that I've made a mistake, I can always buy more and add heddles, in which case I may end up adding a note to each shaft where I added the heddles so that I know how many heddles I have and whether I'm going to run out and need to substitute in another shaft or at least be able to figure out what I'm going to do.
The rollers for the computer unit. I'll tell you that contrary to what the instructions will tell you, if you've got 32 shafts, you want to put these white rollers on first. And the reason is because you'll notice that there is a hole on the back side to insert the steel rod that holds these rollers. There is no hole in the front. If you don't put these rollers on before you've lifted this unit up, then the upper back beam will cover this such that you can't get that steel rod in there. I get the feeling that if you had only 16 shafts, you might be able to get the rod in there because, of course, the 16 shaft loom has a shorter metal rod. But with 32 shafts, you better be putting these rollers on before you put the computer up there and lift it. Otherwise, you're going to be lifting the whole unit back down to put those rollers on. And I discovered this problem when I did a dry fit, and I'll show you that in a minute. I don't have a really good picture illustrating this problem. What I did before I put the computer up there was I put these wood beams, these cross pieces, up on top of the loom to make sure that everything was going to fit properly before I had a computer and all this weight on there and it wasn't going to fit. That's when I discovered it didn't fit, and I also tried to fit the rod in there and realized that there was no way that rod was going to go in there because that back beam is going to block it. So when I tried to do my fitting, this is when I found out that this is not going to work. I tried to sand this inner piece off and I just couldn't get it. Couldn't figure out how I was going to do this. And then I finally realized that if I loosened the wedges on this back beam, this is the one that blocks the rollers, if I loosened this, I would get at least 2 millimeters of movement. Leave all these other wedges tight. Just this top one, you can loosen up a little bit so that you don't want to take all of them off because if you take all of them off, the thing's going to fall apart. So only loosen this top one and this top one. You will then get a little bit of movement so that you can get this cross piece to drop in. Then you come back and tighten this up. So this is photo three here is before we got it all lifted up. This is after handyman and handy helper got it lifted up. We were in great shape here.
So once you get the computer lifted on top of the loom, the next thing you want to do is to examine the TechSolve that's coming out of the unit to see if there are any cords that are crossed. Because if the cords are crossed, then you will probably have unexpected shafts lifting and lowering because they're not in the right order. So make sure to uncross those. And then you can start attaching the pre-cut TechSolve to these pieces that are coming out of the Loom's computer unit. Now, what I found is that the fold that gets attached to those pieces of TechSolve come out of the computer, that fold should be at approximately 40 inches. So, and that's just an inch over a meter. So, what I did was I set up a little measuring station, which is a measuring tape on the breast beam, and I pulled it out so that I could just quickly hold the TechSolve to it, find out where approximately 40 inches was, fold it, and then pin it to the piece of TechSolve coming out of the Loom's computer. Now, what I did, which is contrary to what the instructions tell you, is I hung all of the pieces of TechSolve first. Okay, so you see, I ended up with the groovy little 70s curtain here. But I did that so that I wasn't trying to both hang the TechSolve as well as hang the shaft. So once you have all of the pieces of TechSolve hanging there, and I put the arrow pins into the TechSolve so that I wasn't trying to hold a shaft, a loose pin, and this piece of TechSolve that I need to loop up to hold the shaft, I pinned all the arrow pins in, and then I could step into the loom, hold the shaft, and then pin each side. And I did not make any attempts to level the shafts at this point. I just pinned them on wherever I thought it needed to. And the reason I did that was because once you have both sides pinned, whether they're in the right place or not, then it'll be much easier for you to level one side and repin them with the other side being supported by the other pin. Otherwise, you're trying to, level this at the same time that you're trying to hold it and pin it and all this sort of stuff. So let the TechSolve and the pins help you out. Just pin both sides up and then you can attempt to level them. Now, I'm going to tell you that this next step is a mystery. Okay, it's difficult to understand, it's difficult to do, and frankly, I'm not sure I still understand the logic, but I can tell you that if you try to level the shafts without turning on the computer, it is possible that you will level them in the wrong position. Why? Because it turns out there are multiple positions here. And so you want to level them in the most appropriate position. Which position that is, I'm not really sure. But when we followed the instructions, the shafts were not in the right place. So that's where I learned. If you go to the front of the Loom computer, you'll notice that there are two buttons. These two buttons, depending on which one is pushed in and which one is out, will determine whether it's in fast mode, normal mode, or slow mode. When it's in fast mode, then it puts the shafts down into what is the lowest position, or all shafts in the lower shed. If you put it in normal, then the shafts will be a little bit higher, but they are all level. If you put it into slow mode, then you will get effectively the upper shed, and you'll notice that there is a slight lean, the shafts closest to you being lower than the shafts to the back of you. So it's kind of got that angle. And this I found out totally accidentally. And like I said, I'm not sure if I assume this was put there on purpose, but not sure I totally understand it. So don't ask me for help on this one. Not sure I can provide it. I can tell you that if you're having problems getting the computer to behave in this way, what you need to do is pull out the USB cord from the front of the Loom computer. Okay, and if you don't have a USB cord, then you've got an older unit that I don't know anything about. But the newer units, they have a USB cord in the front. Okay, you pull that out, you turn on the computer. It will then do this marching action with the sheds. If your sheds do not march after a moment, then you really need to turn off your computer, make sure the USB is unplugged, and turn it on again. Now, you don't want to like flip it on and off. That's not going to work. You need to turn it off, wait a few seconds, and then turn it on. Once the unit causes a temporary marching action with the sheds, then you can start pushing the buttons in the front to move it into fast mode, normal mode, or slow mode. Now you'll notice that in fast mode, the shafts should be roughly so that the bottom pieces of wood are roughly aligned or maybe a little bit higher than that crossbar on the side of the loom. The warp is going to be at the same level as the bottom of the reed. In normal mode, it's a little bit higher than the bottom of the reed and the shafts are lifted. And in slow mode or the upper shed, it's not quite at the top of the reed. And obviously, there's a slight slanted shape in the top of the shafts in slow mode. If you intend to put a sectional beam onto your loom, the best thing to do is to order it without the warp beam apron. Why? Because that warp beam apron, not only does it cost extra, but it is a pain in the butt to remove. So what you need are your safety glasses and an upholstery staple remover. Even the regular staple removers were just a pain in the butt. In order to use the upholstery staple remover, I had to hold it at 45 degrees to the beam and really dig under that staple to get it out. And in many cases, the only one leg of the staple came out, which is why I needed the pliers to pull the other leg of the staple out. If you are patient, the staples will come out and you will end up with a lot of dents and staple holes, as you can see. But don't worry about that because your sectional beam is going to cover that up and everything's going to be okay. When I added the sectional beam, I'll tell you the reason I didn't order one from Toika is because they're very expensive. And I really think that part of this expense is the cost to ship the thing. So that's where a lot of people suggest that you buy a LeClaire one if you're in the United States, because it'll cost a lot less. I also think the LeClaire sectional rakes are not as tall, so it's less wood, and they have these extensions that you can use if you want your sectional beam to be larger. In any case, regardless of where you get these sectional beams from, you want to make sure that you install them so that they are all lined up. Because if you install them and they're not all lined up in the same place, then as you wind your warp, the warp will probably not fall into the sections neatly. So what I did was I took a piece of wood and I put it between the sectional beam and the beam of the loom so that I could get a consistent distance between these two areas. And as I attached each of the sectional rakes, I made sure that they were each equidistant from the side of the beam. That way I knew that the rakes would all line up as you turn the beam. And that'll make it just so much easier to warp the loom each time you want to do that. I used ribbon dupes instead of string dupes. I think that the ribbons are much easier to see, and they also kind of flatten out that area so that you don't have the ridge of the string. I honestly don't think it's going to make that much of a difference, but I think my ribbons are prettier. And like I said, they create this flat area for your warp to sit on. The other thing is, I would say that if I had my druthers, I would staple the ribbon to the beam. The only reason I didn't do that and I used a dowel and I attached them using that dowel was because I did not want to haul my air compressor into the house. But if I'd gotten smarter, I probably could have done all of this in the garage, stapled them on in the garage, and then everything would have been fine. So the other point I'll make is that I did alternate colors of ribbon. And the reason I did that is because it's very easy for the ribbon to jump hoops. And so I found that it was easier to detect that problem if I had alternated the colors. And that way you know whether you're grabbing the correct dupe for the correct section. The last thing I'll talk about is the doorway. A lot of people talk about how they love to have their doorway in a traditional Swedish loom. And so I was convinced that I needed a doorway, because maybe there's some adjusting inside of the loom that I need to do and I will need the doorway to get in. Turns out when I assembled the loom and I had 32 shafts in there plus a sectional beam, my doorway was gone. I only have about 8 inches between the 32nd shaft and the sectional beam. And so I think only Barbie, who is a trained hurdle jumper, could actually fit into that doorway and do anything useful in there. Plus, you've got the worm gear pole, which is what this is, as well as the warp beam turner thing here. You don't have a doorway anymore. The other side is open, but obviously I can't get into the other side. And even if I could, you still would have to be as thin as Barbie. So I'm not convinced that I need the doorway anymore, which is a good thing since I don't have one anymore. So any adjusting I need to do, I just lean over from the backside and everything is cool. Bye-bye, doorway.